Mr. Mayor, Mayoress, honored guests, ladies and gentlemen, I'm the head of the University, George Holmes, for those of you who don't know me. It's my great privilege this evening to welcome our friends to the University again, and also our guest victim, I think we'll call peace tonight, to Gordon Burns's very relaxed style that has become so familiar to us here at the University. It just gives me a moment, and it's interesting, Judge Morris, who's the deputy chair of our governing body, says, never give that man a microphone, is his comment, but they have, so just bear with me for 1 second, will you? It is a great privilege tonight because the town and gown are so close in that this is, I think, the mayor's last official duty as mayor in this university at the moment, and so it's a great privilege for me to say thank you so much to the mayor for everything he's done for this university in his term of office. I should be writing to you more formally, sir, but you've done a marvellous job for promoting the town as the first citizen, but also for promoting this university. And can you just join me in thanking our mayor? Forget ably assisted by one, indeed both, of his mayoresses, who again, just join me if you will. Now, to business. You are in the fastest growing university in Britain. Whatever anybody says to you about Bolton as a town and a university, our applications for this September are up over 25% on last year. And that's against a sector average of about what, Nigel? 1-2% across the sector. So we're storming ahead. We're storming ahead in sorts of specialist areas. Performance engineering is doing particularly well, and we received a grant from the Funding Council last November for our new National Centre for Motorsport Engineering, which we are building at a cost of £10 million on the Commission Street site where the former housing was built. The university was pleased to note its progress in the league tables. Now remember, these league tables run 3 years behind with their data. So they're running behind our strategy in terms of their positioning. We moved up 5 places this time. It's interesting how the press can make that not quite sound as good as it seems. But if you look at the 2 key measures on those league tables, student satisfaction and the staff-student ratio, we're in the top 75 in the country out of 126 when you look at those 2 attributes. Now, student satisfaction is critically important to any university. And to be in that top 75 in the country out of 126 universities is very important to us. Yes, they have a go at us on having relatively low entry standards. We call it access to higher education. We call it opportunity. We call it giving people from Bolton a chance to get into the education system at higher level. Oxford and Cambridge and equivalent universities call it standards and elitism. It's the final ism available in this country that's acceptable, elitism. You can't have racism or sexism or any other ism but elitism. But under elitism, the league tables put Oxford and Cambridge at the top because their students are the brightest in the land when they enter. Ours are amongst the best in the land when they enter because they're passionate, they're committed, they're enthusiastic, and they want to learn. And those students come from educational backgrounds that aren't the most elite in the land, but they do benefit massively from their education here. So as the fastest growing university in the land, who admits students from the widest possible backgrounds to some of the best possible facilities, on this area, this education zone that have been overseen by this local authority, in the last 10 years while I've been here, £165 million in capital has been spent on educational facilities here, with us and the 2 colleges, and now the UTC. We're on the cusp of something massive here in Bolton, and it's therefore newsworthy that the head of the BBC is here tonight to take us forward in terms of showing how people's spectacularly successful careers can be enhanced and developed by their involvement in the Northwest. The head of the BBC for England, I think Gordon Burns, is going to do the introductions. You are indeed very welcome in this institution, sir.
Okay.
Gordon Burns.
Thank you. Well, good evening, everybody, and could I add my welcome to you all, to many faces I see returning and some new faces as well. You're all most welcome here tonight. And I think I can promise you a totally fascinating, absorbing, and enlightening evening as we hear all about the arrival of the BBC to the brand new MediaCity UK in Salford, and the enormous logistical operation it involved, moving hundreds and hundreds of people up from London, not necessarily all wanting to come, and into their new working areas, with all the technology in place and working efficiently. And of course, MediaCity mushrooming today. We're delighted to add, therefore, the name of the man behind that amazing operation to the impressive and illustrious list, I think you'll agree, of outstanding special guests we have who have honored us here with their presence in the support of the University of Bolton's Business School. And he is, of course, the BBC's Director, England, Peter Salmon. Peter is a true northerner who grew up not very far from here. And it was Peter who had the overall responsibility of moving five major departments, which included children, sports, and live, plus the BBC breakfast programme, of course, up from London. But that decision to move a large chunk of the BBC up to MediaCity UK came under considerable fire from sections of the media, from sections of MPs, and indeed within the BBC too. But today, the ever-expanding MediaCity is generally regarded as a huge success. And if you haven't been down there to have a look, it is well worth going down and seeing around it. It is just fantastic. And of course, with the BBC's much-heralded sports department moving up from London, it meant the massive BBC coverage of London 2012 Olympic Games in terms of the technology came under Peter Salmon's domain. And that meant with the controversy over the move of these departments up here, and particularly resisted by sport, that they had to get the technology right for the Olympic Games in a very short period of time. And in many ways, as Peter was a champion of departments moving up here, whether they wanted to or not, his head, I think, was very much on the line that the technology was right and that the London Olympic Games was the success that it was. We shall talk about all those things in the interview, which is about to follow. But we'll also talk about his roots and the career path that took him to this highly prestigious position he now holds as BBC Director England. I said earlier he grew up not far from here. He is, in fact, a Burnley lad and a very, very keen supporter of Burnley FC. All right. His rise through the media ranks included a spell at Channel 4, being the boss of BBC One and being the director of BBC Sport, where he triumphantly won back from ITV Match of the Day and England International Matches. Peter is married to the brilliant award-winning Oldham-born actress Sarah Lancashire, who you will all know, I'm sure, and has starred in a whole host of TV dramas from Coronation Street in the early days, Raquel. through to the recent totally outstanding series, both of them, of Last Tango in Halifax and Happy Valley. And it's time now to hear from Peter. When the interview is over, you will have the opportunity to put questions to him. And well, you've never let me down so far in all these sessions, so I'm sure you have some pretty good questions for him. So ladies and gentlemen, would you give a huge Bolton welcome to BBC's Director England and the man in charge of the BBC at MediaCity UK and indeed every other base, BBC base in England, Peter Salmon. Well, always, Peter, I feel in interviews best to plunge
Burnley,
in.
The Burnley thing was difficult, I thought.
Well, I was going to say, well, you see, this is why you got to the top. You're anticipating me now, because I'm going to plunge in at the deep end with probably the most important question and the most difficult one for you to answer, and that is there any hope of beloved Burnley avoiding relegation?
Well, there's mathematical hope, there's technical hope, but I fear there may not be much realistic footballing hope. I think we're right on the brink, aren't we? Which is, but we will get to play Bolton. Akil and myself, Akil who runs religion for the BBC, who I know works here occasionally, we said at least Bolton Wanderers and Burnley will get to play again, at least for one season, next season. Is that me?
Who knows?
Is that my stomach? I fear. So there's some consolation.
I mean, you are a genuine fan who goes to the matches, not a David Cameron type football fan.
though we both sport claret and blue, of course. On occasion,
well, that is true. Yes, yeah. You should have put that in as well. Are you heartbroken?
No, I'm realistic. I'm realistic. I think we did fantastically well going up. You know, we're a It's a modest-sized football club in a medium-sized town, wonderful town. But it, you know, we battled against the odds and went up. We got a wonderful manager, great squad, lovely spirit, fantastic support from the town. But probably, you know, we've been, I hate to say it, we've been slightly out of our depth in a, you know, a league full of Chelsea's and Man City's and Liverpool's and all the rest of it. But, you know, we've been very game. We've given it a go. We've really enjoyed ourselves. We're very buoyant as, you know, we sing more loudly the more we're being beaten, it seems to me, Burnley fans, which is just as well over the years. But, no, we enjoy our football, and the football club, a bit like Bolton Wanderers, means a lot in the town, and it means a lot to me.
Sure. And growing up as a child in Bolton, you presumably went along there as a kid to watch the team.
In Burnley, yeah, I did. I was a junior claret. I played a bit of football myself. I fancied myself as a footballer. I wasn't, as Akil knows again, I wasn't really that good enough to. But like all men, I still fancy myself, by the way, as a footballer. I play five-a-side, not very well. I hobble around a five-a-side pitch a bit. And I also worked selling programmes on Turf Moor, and I worked selling pies and peas behind the Beehole End, which was an illustrious old Burnley end of the ground. And that was part of... Everybody in the town had a relationship with the club. We felt, you know, in the same way, I think, that people must feel when they see the University of Bolton. You know, you look at these institutions in the middle of these little northern towns, and I think you feel immensely proud of them because they, you know, they speak for something, and the big teams come, and they do big things, and they're full of aspiration and all the rest of it. So, yeah, you know, whether it's about, you know, romance, business, sport, whatever, a lot of it's tangled up in the fortunes of Burnley for me.
Because I remember you telling me the first time you ever saw Burnley Football Club was with your dad when they came back from Wembley, yeah, having lost the cup final, yeah, to Tottenham. But what, you were on your dad's shoulders.
Yeah.
So he was a big fan, was he?
No, he wasn't, actually. He was I've got to be honest, my dad was a, you know, my dad's an Irishman. My dad was a, he didn't really get football. I think he fancied himself as a bit of footballer because, of course, we had Jimmy McElroy playing for Burnley back in the day.
Great hero.
Some Irish greats. but no, I think I picked it up at school. It was, you know, it was part that everybody loved football probably in Burnley, apart from my dad, actually. My dad was too busy, you know, he's self-employed, he's a window cleaner. And, you know, I think hurling and Gaelic football and all sorts of things were in my dad's DNA, yeah, but not necessarily football or soccer, you know.
You see, that's interesting because I was going to ask you about family background, because most people think, or the image, I would say, of a BBC boss is a middle or upper class Oxbridge type. That's the general public image of a BBC head. And yet...
I've tried to become that more recently, is it showing?
But you were very much then a working class family.
Very much so. Yeah, very proud of that. I'm very, you know, very proud of... My dad was an Irish first generation Irishman. He came across at the back end of the war and served in the RAF and did a bit of all of that stuff. And then he met my mum in one of those classic kind of northern mill town romances. And then, we grew up in Burnley, and I loved it. It was a, you know, fun, spirited, characterful, colourful little town.
Did you help him clean windows?
I didn't help. Well, I think he'd dispute that if he was here, by the way. I wasn't really great at cleaning windows. I didn't have my dad's head for heights, actually, really. But I used to collect his money. My dad used to send me in. Well, the difficult battle always was getting the money out of the customers. I mean, inevitably, you know, paying for your window cleaning was not necessarily, you know, if you didn't have a lot of money, it wasn't necessarily your first order. There was food and there was rent and there was lots of other things. And when the window cleaner came around on a Friday night, it was often quite a tough gig getting the cash out of people. Right. So I think it was quite canny, actually. He used to send me around, you know, age 12 with his little notebook with all his houses listed, you know, Lydia Street, Herbert Street, Every Street, Harold Street, whatever. And my job was to try and get the cash out of people.
How much?
Might just be 50p a house. It might be. It wouldn't be much. But I'll tell you what, a lot of lights went out when they saw me coming. They did. I used to walk up these streets in Burnley, and the lights would have just all... I think they had a kind of lookout at the end of each street, you know. And I went back recently, and some bloke called me, and he said to me, she must be quite elderly, but he was laughing. He said, I told my mum I was seeing you tonight, and she said to apologies, we still owe you 54p from 1976. She said, we were in, but we didn't answer the door. But it was quite canny. I think he sent me because I think he thought I had a better chance of getting the money than he would.
It's interesting. That was your first, really, experience of money, and from collecting 50p's around the houses. I mean, you now handle multi-million pound budgets. It's absolutely phenomenal.
Yeah. Well, you're right. The, that stuff, you know, the early, you know, mental arithmetic. I mean, it's kind of a funny thing, isn't it? It's a mix of both, isn't it? It was a mix of trying to get the right money, trying to make sure that the takings added up, but also sort of trying to charm it out of people too. You had to, you know, you didn't extricate it easily. Yeah. There was normally an Alsatian involved, you know, when you knocked on the door in my area. So you had to work quite hard to get that money. And I think that's what I've had to do in the BBC and in the rest of my career is, how do you get the money from London? How do you get the cash out to invest it in places like MediaCity? And I think that's kind of part of the process too, isn't it?
I suppose running departments started by running the pie shop at Burnley FC, which wasn't as easy as it sounds, because those were the days, weren't they, when there was no segregation at Grants.
No, it was a very rough time. It was a very nice time, but yeah, it used to be, it seemed to me you were trying to sell pies in the middle of a riot, you know, because fans were... It wasn't just Blackburn Rovers, by the way, or Bolton. I mean, there were some pretty rowdy visiting fans, and they, for whatever reason, they seemed to make a beeline for my vat of peas on occasions. And I always remember I had a huge ladle, and from time to time I have to use it quite forcefully on Nottingham Forest fans or something, you know, which was a bit of a pleasure. But, yeah, it was quite rough back in the day. I mean, football, thankfully, football, a lot of that's changed in football now. It's often a kind of pleasure to go on there.
But you clearly had a lot of go in you, you know, working with your dad to collect the money, going to work in the pie shop at Burnley, and you were obviously clearly very bright because from going through school in Burnley, you landed a place at the University of Warwick studying...
English and European literature, yes. And I went there. I don't know if I told you. Tell you why I went to Warwick. I went to Warwick because in a sense, shows you how lucky but how kind of warped and twisted my imagination was in some ways as well, because... It was the only university magazine that had a picture of a graduating footballer in it, and that was Steve Highway. Do you remember Steve Highway?
Of course, yeah.
He had a little Zapata moustache, he looked quite trendy, had long hair. And I think he was called Big Bamba, and then on the other wing there was Little Bamba, Brian Hall. Right. And they were the two, I think there were only two footballers probably that had a degree or a couple of A-levels to rub together. And he was in a magazine, and I thought, well, this university stuff must be fun if Steve Highway goes there. And that's why I eventually scraped into Warwick University. Mm.
And when you went there, and indeed when you graduated in 1977, did you have an idea of the career you wanted to embark on? Were you aiming for something?
I think I remember saying to a careers advisor person when I was about 14 that I wanted to work on the Burnley Express. So I think I knew that I wanted to be a writer. I didn't know what a journalist was, maybe a reporter. I knew I wanted to write stories. I love stories, you know, whether it was consuming books or writing things or essays or whatever it might be. And I remember I had a bit of a put down, actually. It's kind of interesting. He said to me, well, that's all very well, he said to me, but you probably should go and try and work in a bank. I always remember this, and I remember my mum, myself left. My dad was terrific, but my mum kind of took a bit more interest in my school life and all sorts of things. She'd come with me, and I think she rounded on him, actually, you know, in fairly robustly, and told him to kind of mind his own business. What would he know about what her son was going to be? And she was kind of one of those Laurentian women, you know, those powerful working class women who, you know, when she took you to places, and when she took you to the front of the queue, and when she told you to do things, you kind of did it. I mean, she was, you know, warm and fun and all sorts of things, but she knew at some point she had to kind of push you out of the nest and get you out there to make your fame and fortune, as it were. So very grateful to her.
But you started as a teacher rather than straight into journalism.
Yeah, I did. I became a volunteer teacher. I did a VSO, you know, voluntary service overseas. And I remember I just talking about the whole all the happy accidents of your life. They asked me at the interview. They said, where do you want to go in the whole world and be a teacher? I didn't really know much about the whole world. I knew about as far as Accrington, I think. And I said, I was at university, but my horizons were very limited. I think I'd only been on a plane once. I didn't really know the world. And I said, well, I'll tell you what I'd like to do. I kind of made it on the spot, really. I said, I'd like to go to the Caribbean because of cricket. I think they just thought, right. I always remember this. And then when the offer came, like, Caribbean cricket, that's interesting. I always remember the offer came through and it went, it was as far away from the Caribbean as it could possibly be. I always thought somebody on the section panel had a sense of humor. It went, Sarawak, East Malaysia. I didn't know where it was. I didn't know what it was. I didn't know how I get there. I didn't know what they did there. It was in, you know, it's in Borneo. It's a long way away from Accrington and Burnley. And it was brilliant. It was a fantastic education. It was tough. leaving the town with my mates, doing all that stuff, being away for so long. It's very remote, but it was, in many ways, it was kind of making of me. I'm not sure what the kids there got out of it, apart from, you know, broad Lancastrian accents. But I got a lot out of it. Yeah, yeah. I learned to stand on my own two feet.
But when you then moved into a local newspaper, which is the best grounding for any journalist, I'm much older than you, a journalist will tell you. But how did you land that job?
Yeah, that was another one of those things that you do. I came back from being a VSO teacher because my dad had got lung cancer and he was very poorly. So I came back to Burnley. I worked in some paint factories and things. It was quite funny, quite tough jobs. And then I eventually, my dad recovered, and I eventually went down to London. And in London, I worked for the civil service briefly. It was a job. I didn't think I wanted to do it forever. But I decided I wanted to get into local papers. And there used to be a magazine called the UK Press Gazette. I'm not sure if it's still a magazine. It was a monthly or a weekly. And I decided to advertise myself in the Situations Wanted section. So I think whatever I said about myself, anyway, I made myself sound quite colourful. And I said, you know, it was kind of hard working, something, boy, wants to learn the trade, we'll work for peanuts in whatever. Well, they paid you peanuts. I mean, that bit came true. And I went to work in a local paper in North Kent. I got offered a job by an editor who saw this and thought it was a fairly novel way of applying for a job. I think he also thought it was quite cheap. He didn't have to advertise. I was already available. And he took me on a trial basis, and I was lucky. I learned a lot from that newspaper. Mm.
But during that time, you obviously decided broadcasting was the way you wanted to go because you applied for one of the BBC training jobs, which are not easy to get.
No, I realised I didn't want to be. I'd done a lot of by that stage. I think in local paper terms, I was reasonably successful. I was getting all the front page stories, doing a bit of sport. I really loved it. It was great. And I began to do a few shifts on Sunday papers and a bit of freelancing for tabloids and things. And I didn't really like what I saw. I didn't really like the world that I was getting into. I felt that it wasn't a world I'd necessarily enjoy, interestingly, particularly the kind of tabloid side of it. I felt it had a kind of nasty edge to it that I didn't like. That's the truth. And fortunately enough, a friend of mine, I don't think I'd really ever heard of the BBC or even watched it much. This is a shocking thing to say because I was brought up on Granada and ITV and being from the Northwest. I thought I was from Granada land. Somebody said to me at one point, "Where are you from?" I said, "I'm from Granada land." I did. Like Narnia, you know. And I didn't work with him. I said, "Well, they're not going to want me. I'm a nasty, oikish northerner type thing." They said, "Well, you might just be the person they're looking for." So I applied, and bizarrely, I mean, the interview was all in Latin, and I got it. And it was, by the way, genuinely, when I grew up, I mean, one of the things that's always been on my mind is I had no relationship with the BBC growing up in the north. One other story about just what the BBC and ITV meant to you. I mean, I'm really glad, by the way, I work for the BBC now. I think it's an amazing organisation. It's changed enormously. But I remember that when somebody came to our house once to return my a hammer my dad had lent him, banged on the door. It was one of those streets in Lancashire where you just came straight in. You know, we banged on the door and he came in. So we're like, "Oh, Pat, I've got your hammer." And I remember watching Coronation Street. And my dad got up and he punched the button for BBC Two. And I always remember this. Some bloke was knocking some nails in a piece of wood. It was a kind of DIY Open University program. We're all sitting in the living room. We all went. We looked at the table. We went and found it, actually. My dad went to, "All right, Nigel, yeah, lovely, thanks. So you finished your job?" I grunted and I came back in, pressed the button again for ITV. And we all carried on watching it. But he wanted the guy to think it were BBC Two viewers. I just thought it was, as an act of snobbery or whatever, it was rather brilliant. And it's only kind of 20 years on. I remember that moment and thought, right, now I know what he was doing. He was trying to say something about it.
Does being in the BBC trainee scheme that you were on, did that guarantee you a job at the end, providing you came through it successfully?
No, you came out of that traineeship. It was 2 years. You came out of that traineeship and you applied for jobs. And so I did the old thing. I got a series of contracts. But by that stage, after doing that 2 years, you'd done some great things. It's very privileged. You'd done some wonderful things. Your CV looked and felt terrific. You'd made some great contacts. You know, one of the things about students here and other students is that thing about networking and building your contacts up and getting to know the right people and figuring out how organisations work. I knew a lot about it, so I think I was kind of well on the way.
But no, I did a series of contracts. In fact, I did one at Oxford Road for the BBC. I worked on Farallon 4, the investigative Radio 4 current affairs series. So I got a kind of first taste of working in Manchester, which I loved.
Yeah, and you did things like Crime Watch and Blue Peter, I presume.
I did Blue Peter. I wasn't entirely. I loved Blue Peter because I learnt a lot. Blue Peter, but I wasn't entirely successful because the editor of Blue Peter, Biddy Baxter, who was a formidable
famous
lady, who really was one of the great television. Well, is one of the great television professionals. I think she just thought I was a chippy Northerner, and I used to. I was the most junior member of staff, but I kind of volunteer ideas that were well above my. I complain about things and say things about the programme which were. I don't think I understood office politics. You know, when you first come in, you just sit quietly in a corner and just, you know, take it in first before you start to offer. You know, if you're working in the company of some of the greats of television, I think best to keep stum, at least initially. But so we had a bit of. But I learned an enormous amount from Biddy. She was, you know, when you heard Biddy coming onto the studio floor, because Blue Peter was live twice a week then, and it was often quite fraught. You had to rehearse everything over and over again and then try and do it live kind of perfectly. But things were, you know, when you're working with 8 large Newfoundland dogs or Britain's most talented parakeets, I mean, things were going to go wrong, you know. So, and she quite liked a bit of that, but not exactly. She didn't want anarchy. So it was quite a testing thing to do. It was a brilliant thing to do. I think from working on that live programme, Blue Peter, which was quite tough and quite demanding under her. I then went on to be one of the first, you know, I worked on Crime Watch and I made the first film for Crime Watch and then I produced it. And it was very innovative in its time because it was interactive. Sure. It's a funny thing to say now, everything's interactive now, but it was, people phoned in, it was, you know, extraordinary. Mm. And the phones worked and they phoned detectives and there were real coppers on the set and it was live and it was Nick Ross and Sue Cook and it was. And ethically, it was quite complex. You know, were we crossing? Was the BBC or anybody else crossing a line? Were we working? You know, the office next door was investigating the police, and we were helping them. And there were a lot of kind of moral and ethical issues around all that, which, you know, were quite tricky to resolve. It was a first, but I worked with an amazing team, and that was a great experience. Mm. Learned a lot.
Well, you worked your way up and eventually moved towards management roles rather than programme making. And I'm going to read a list now, but there's a reason for doing it, so bear with me for a second. This is quite a long list here. As you left London to become head of television features at BBC Bristol, you then went to Channel 4 as head of factual programmes, you went to Granada TV as director of programmes, you came back to the BBC to take charge of BBC One. Next stop was head of BBC Sport. You then left the BBC to become chief executive of an independent production company, but soon returned to the BBC to take up a position that sounds, if you'll forgive me, like something straight out of W1A, the BBC comedy show that sends itself up.
Chief Creative Officer.
Chief Creative Officer of BBC Vision Production. And in December 2008 became director of BBC North Group, which made you boss of MediaCity at the time of the move. And of course, now you're director of BBC England, which is quite a list, in fact, it's half a page of list. And I listed it because I'm interested in knowing whether you felt in climbing the greasy pole, so to speak, it is necessary to move regularly along the line, or whether these were just opportunities that came up and you took them. Was it planned or not?
No, I didn't have a plan, but I was always inquisitive, and I didn't like to kind of settle. I didn't like to get comfortable or complacent or go around the hamster wheel too often. The third or fourth time I was going through, I don't know, a finance round or an offers or a commissioning round, I was starting to get bored. I was a kind of younger person. I was quite fidgety, really, intellectually. I always thought, must be what's next. And I think also the world of the media was starting to change fast. You know, the independent sector was, so, you know, in the 90s, Channel 4, you know, 80s, 90s, Channel 4 erupted. And it was brilliant. It was very disruptive and really interesting. And I thought, you know, I've got to leave the BBC. The BBC's not the only game in town. Well, you know, see Granada and ITV. And there were this new kid on the block, this new, you know, cocky, you know, we were the kind of standing army and they were the guerrilla army, really. And they were doing lots of interesting things. Michael Grade ran it and all the rest of it. The director of programs was a wonderful investigative journalist called John Willis. So I thought I could learn something by being with those guys. And I left really to be with great people. I thought some of it might rub off. I mean, I think that's the only advice I'd offer people is spot somebody you think is remarkable, if you can, and then try and get close to them. because at some point they might share a bit of the fairy dust with you, a bit of the magic dust with you. And that's kind of why I moved around. I was curious. The world was changing. There were new ways of doing things. People were doing things differently. New companies were starting out. And also, nobody stopped me. I mean, cool. The other thing I think to think about is about careers. You know, if I was a student or whatever it is, don't let people stop you. Don't stop yourself. Don't erect. Don't think to yourself, I'm just a boy from Burnley, or I'm just a window cleaner. I never gave that two hoops. I just kept going. You know, I put my foot down, and I didn't look in the rearview mirror too much. I just kept going, and no one stopped me. And I found the BBC and other bits of the media to be very open, very egalitarian. You know, up for a bit of new DNA, new thinking, a bit of challenge, all the rest of it. That's why I worked in Granada. I wanted to go to Granada because there was this incredibly famous company I'd worked in previously, because the BBC didn't have a big office in Manchester like Granada had. So I wanted to go and absorb some of that. And I'm so glad I did. I'm so glad I was curious. And I'm so glad ultimately I ended up at MediaCity, because I felt like by that stage, yeah, I was ready to do that very big job.
I mean, let's talk about MediaCity. I don't think you were with the BBC at the time the battle went on between Salford and Manchester as to who would get MediaCity. It meant a lot to both Manchester Council, Salford Council, battling it out. And it ended up in Salford, when I think everybody expected, including a lot of people in the BBC, it would have to be Manchester. What was it about Salford that won the BBC there?
I think it's fairly obvious now, because of course we can see MediaCity. It's the scale, the ambition, the ability to expand and be expansive. It feels like it felt like a game changer, the Salford plan. I mean, Manchester's a wonderful city too. I mean, obviously, for me, the boundaries are kind of indivisible. I love being in Salford, but the space, the freedom, the community we're a part of. You know, we're not downtown with the shops and with the railway station, all that sort of stuff. But we're alongside Coronation Street, we're alongside ITV, and we're with Red Productions, and we're with Salford University, and we're alongside the Lowry Theatre, the Imperial War Museum, and God forbid, not far off from Man United, and all the rest.
Hey.
And I love it. I love it. I love the sense of scale and ambition. I feel every time I walk across the I'm not sure you can say the word piazza in the north, but it's a piazza. Yeah. I see now why it won the bid, because it had that. It was a dreamer's idea, I think. You know, nothing like this exists really anywhere. I don't think it does in media terms. It's unique, and it would have been hard to do that in downtown Manchester. We would have been terrific, but we couldn't have done it on this scale with this ambition.
Sure. And we're delighted to have the mayor of Salford here, who's obviously delighted the BBC are in Salford. So when the site was decided upon and the buildings went up and the big move neared, as I said in my introduction, five major departments were moved up from London. How did you set about deciding which department would come to London?
How long have you got? I was involved in this at different stages. It took so long, just in W1A fashion. So it took a long time for BBC to do this, because it cost a lot of money. It needed a lot of approval. We had to get a license fee that we could, so that we could afford it. We had to do a whole bunch of different things. So I was involved in the very initial phase with Greg Dyer. And I put together the early plan for who would move.
Who was Director General?
Greg Dyer, sorry, was the Director General back in the day. And then I left the BBC to join the independent sector. Meanwhile, the Salford Manchester decision was made, as it were, by Mark Thompson, who became the new Director General. What was the question again? How did we decide?
How did you decide on the five departments?
Sorry, you're right. It is. If only the head of values were here. It was a really interesting process. It was a mix of pragmatism. I went round the BBC and rattled it in, really, and said, what have you got? Who have you got? What can you spare as governor? A bit of that, because the BBC, at least then, was run as fiefdoms, really, in some ways, by very powerful mandarins, and it was quite hard to get them to part with something that you were going to do something kind of risky with, that no one else had done, that most people probably thought would fail. So there's a lot of parsimoniousness, if that's a word. inside the BBC, and that was quite tricky. And then there was a sense, and then we began to work to put together a kind of vision for what the BBC could be, mm-hmm. and how the BBC might interact with audiences in 10 years' time, because it would take that long to land this thing. And we began to think about the new relationship we're having with audiences, the kind of interactive one, the one where audiences were starting to think differently, interact differently, behave differently with content. We began to think about departments that were facing off with audiences, like children's and sport in particular, to new emerging audiences that were into that first, you know, sports-driven a lot of the innovation in the BBC and in the technical sector around the media. Children are born into this world. And we began to kind of do a bit of that stuff, really, dream a little bit and triangulate some of those things. We had this idea that we'd become a centre for the BBC in the age of the internet, for bits of the BBC that were open culturally, that had that interactive relationship with licence fee payers, that could work with each other and share roles and, you know, trade content at the edges. So Five Live and Sport were always a kind of interesting proposition, radio and telly, etc., etc. So we, you know, it was a vision of the BBC as a more open, interactive, license fee facing proposition. It was also, it's true, there was a degree of kind of pragmatism. What could I get the kind of great chieftains of the BBC back in the day, you know, between myself and Greg Dyke and a few others, to part with and give us so that we could make an impact, make a noise, and do something substantial. I also wanted to take bits to the north of England that were more self-commissioning, because, you know, the one thing that's difficult to shift from London is, you know, budgets and sign-off and power, all those things that every national organisation grapples with. You know, decision makers make decisions in London, and at some point, if you're lucky, the cheque arrives in, you know, in the north of England type thing. But I wanted the power in Salford, so it was important to me that Children's, which is self-commissioning, you know, we decide our own fate, we commission our own programmes on our own channels, Sport, which is dependent on deals, on rights, and all that stuff, and which is largely self-commissioning, Five Live, which is a complete entity in itself, BBC Learning, but by the way, and by the way, BBC Religion, which had a lot of commissioning power back in the day, in its in and of itself. But remember, we're more than just five departments. There's 23 different. The great thing about MediaCity, which is its magic, I think, for the BBC, is that 23 different bits of the BBC are represented there. So the whole of the BBC, the thing I wanted to construct was the place that the whole of the BBC had a shareholding in. I'm the chairman of the board. And so Steve Mawinney here, who lives in Bolton, who runs news for BBC News, who's on my board, who also runs the news for Five Live, he represents news as interest in Salford. We've got television in Salford, we've got radio in Salford, we've got future media in Salford under the BBC North banner. But these are all elements of the big trading box of the BBC. They've all got a substantial investment in its success. And that was really important to me. And it was really important to me that they all wanted it to succeed. Because the last thing you want to think with a national organisation is some powerful elements of it wanting it to fail.
Yeah.
And, you know, I was moving after all, and Steve was moving, and lots of us moving, hundreds of people to the north of England who were a bit dubious, some of them. And you know, they were giving them into our care, had this duty of care for it to succeed. Mm. I thought it would, because I'd worked at Granada like you. Mm. I felt the north would be a splendid place for it. They were a bit unsure. So I wanted to make sure the kind of shareholding.
But there was real resistance. I mean.
Well, there was certainly uncertainty.
Well, we're talking about hundreds and hundreds of people who are going to be uprooted, leave their families, their houses, their golf club, this, that, and the other to move up here. Just how do you deal with that?
Well, I think you've got to create. You know, this is not to be too poncy about the whole thing. You've got to. I set about creating an exciting vision for. It helped, by the way, that it eventually looked like this. Yeah. We didn't really know at the time. I kept pointing out the Larry Theatre at lots of industrial waste and going, one day. And I kept thinking, one day I'm going to come in, it's not going to be raining, by the way. Yeah, and people were sceptical, but I think we created a kind of sense of excitement, of a mission, of a vision, of a relationship with audiences, of a different kind of BBC. A B- BBC where you can have a career where maybe also you could move about a bit. Because BBC, like a lot of organisations, can be quite siloed. So a lot of people felt they wanted to be somewhere which would open all the great stuff the BBC did to them. And they could have careers in lots of different bits of it without getting stuck. And we've created that in MediaCity. It's a much more open, fluid, flexible working environment, partly technological, partly cultural. So we had to create a kind of a vision for the place. The big thing I set out to do, and I think you might have a film that might, from the early days, that might just show partly how we did it. I think you have to feel you're going to do something big, you're going to change, you've got to feel something. It can't just be, we've got this intellectual idea, it all makes sense, it's a brilliant strategy, look at it, loads of wires, lots of diagrams, lots of shapes, lots of whatever it might be, lozenges, pastels, bright colours. People got, that's the head. But the thing that makes people move is the heart. You know, my big thing is, I read somewhere about the boy on the elephant. The story about the boy on the elephant. This elephant is a kind of colossus. And it can trample people to death, it can wreck villages, and it can, maraud through jungles. And on top of it is a little, but it's that, the brains is up there, this little boy with a bit of bamboo. And the elephant is the way people feel about things, and the boy is the brains on top. But we all know the elephant's got the muscle, and the elephant's the dangerous bit, and the elephant's got all that pork and scale. And the little boy, the way you know where you want to go is on top, trying to make this massive muscle and instinct and all that other stuff, go in the right direction. It's a bloody hard job, but you've got to make the heart and the head work together. And if you do, I genuinely think you can create profound and fundamental change.
Well, as I say, there was this moment when you were persuading people to come up north, and you made this film to tell them it's a great place up here.
Try and make you smile and make you laugh.
You can easily do that. Just write a big check out.
Excited going to London and seeing Media Centre and TVC and White City, but this just looks like it's going to top them all.
Oh, come on, we've got a job to do.
Stand by, everybody. 21 on a cut. Lose the caption. One red and white.
It feels like an incredibly creative place. Most of the creativity is obviously to do with music and football, but there's no reason why the film industry shouldn't become a partner in that.
There seems to be a real drive here at the moment to produce new and interesting stuff.
And creative industries just seem to thrive up here in the north, I think. I think it's just an attitude.
That's quite inspiring to be around, that sort of energy.
Got 19 for 8.
Yeah, let's build the atmosphere, guys. Good stuff, this. And cut 10, off you go.
You've got great people, great attitudes, great cities, great countryside.
They love it. They absolutely will love it.
Very, very bold, creative ideas and a warmth and willingness to work with people that you don't get so quickly in other parts of the country.
That's a good thing.
What are you doing?
People are scared of change and they think it's going to mean a bad thing for them. It'll be scary, but this is a really positive change.
It's a super place.
It really is, yeah. It's fantastic.
Somewhere that's going to have its own heart and its own vibrancy and own culture to it.
It's got more bars per square inch than any other place on the planet Earth.
We have the best fish and chips.
That's my fault, yeah?
Back studio. Hughesy, tell us when you're ready. 22. We will take another interview. You boys record it.
And in the northwest.
London's great and it does one thing, but this is a real bold statement saying there's a chance to do something great up here.
You shouldn't knock it till you've tried it.
You get more of a community feel up here, and I love it, and I wouldn't live anywhere else.
It's another wonderful win!
The biggest advantage for me is the amount of talent that's based up here.
Attitude.
It's people and it's talent.
Cheek. Originality.
Just general gorgeousness.
We need you!
It's not it's the north. The north.
Oh, shut the north.
You only got one small line, you buggered it up.
So, when you played this to Southerners who are thinking the North is horrible and evil and so on, and you had BBC Sport jumping up and down saying, we shouldn't be going up there, we've got Wembley Stadium, Twickenham, the FA, everything's in London, and BBC Breakfast jumping up and down saying, we can't go up there, we'll never get another celebrity ever to appear on our programme again because they'll never come to Manchester, and you show them a film like this, does it do the trick?
Well, it helps. It helps. I mean, it needs to be a plan, a lot of thought, and a process, a lot of stuff. I had a fantastic team who helped me devise the plan and make sure it worked and make sure we thought through the technology. I'm not a technologist, and I know what you need, but ultimately I don't know kind of how to install it. I don't know what you're going to need in 5 years' time. So, you know, we planned brilliantly too. I had a great team on it. You know, the story I was telling is that we, in the move, you know, we moved about 1,000 people from the south of England. I mean, not all of them, you know, some rented, some bought, some gave it a chance, some people moved on since, all the rest of it. 1,000 people gave us a go, and we wanted that business continuity, we wanted those people to come with us. We only lost one woman's handbag in the entire move. I always love that story, and we found that the next day. And I think that's amazing to think we did all that. We moved, I think, forgetting now, it's something like 70 different teams on over however many weekends, and nothing fell off air, nothing went wrong. I mean, you know, touch wood, it's probably all falling to pieces now back at the base, but I probably cursed it, but it worked, and and we did it sequentially. We did the less risky stuff first, and we moved bits of department by bits of department, so there were people, as it were, to welcome the next wave coming in, to show them where the loos and the cafes and the pubs and the wires and the bits and bobs were. We were very systematic and very logical and very careful. You know, we did some other things. We, you know, Match of the Day, for instance, when we moved it, we did some dual running. You know, we ran Match of the Day, which is really complicated little show. You may think it's, you know, people think it's quite formulaic. It really isn't. It's really complicated. We ran that in London and in Salford for 4 or 5 weeks together, until we were absolutely sure, you know, we didn't want it to fall off air. So we ran all those films and all those bits and all those graphics in from two different centres at the same time. Then we were absolutely sure it worked. We pulled the plugs on London, and we just did it in Salford. And some of those really iconic moments we were really careful about. And if you think about things like, and then we had the Olympics. And we had, remember it was against the backdrop, just two or three quite funny things, against the backdrop of some quite colourful headlines about the move, about how we'd find things, about what wouldn't work and what would work. And just to give you two, I think there's three or four things that I still remember. One was that someone wrote that London staff would struggle to move to Salford to Manchester because of the shortage of speciality cheese shops. That was one thing that I thought was fantastic. I just love the fact that I felt like saying, well, there's a really good cheese shop in Didsbury. You want to go to Didsbury, there's a really good cheese shop. We used to live there. And then we had another story that because Namby Pamby BBC staff, this is like something with W1A, because Namby Pamby BBC staff needed cotton wooling, that I'd employed some chair champions to help people work out how to use the chairs like that. Some chair champions, you really couldn't make that up, so just to work out how to sit ergonomically in chair. I'll say my best one till last, because the mayor of Salford's here, I better be careful of this one. But my next but last funny one was because BBC staff had not used trams before, that we'd employ some tram trainers to to help people figure out the trams, which I did love. And then finally, about a year into our move, I remember the Daily Sport, so it must be true, the Daily Sport writing that business in Salford brothels had boomed since the BBC had moved up, which I've been blamed for some things in my time, but I thought that was a bit rich.
But, I mean,
so it was against that backdrop, dropping that. I mean, that made it complicated.
I mean, you mentioned complicated. I mean, you mentioned there the Olympic Games. Now, BBC technology moved up and sport was due to come up.
Yeah.
And this was the most massive opportunity. You'd only been in, the move into Media City began in 2011, and you had the 2012 Olympics, and all the technology for that massive operation of covering the Olympics and taking it to the world was going to come from Salford. And this was in your domain, and you were the man who'd been telling sport and everybody, it's all fine up here, come up, everything's great, etc. I mean, you must, I'm not saying the exact word I'm thinking about, but you must have been, to put it mildly, as Fergie would have said, it must have been squeaky bum time for you. Because
there was one moment, I'll never forget the word,
because,
one moment.
Well, if that had gone wrong, if it was too early for MediaCity and it was wobbling, I mean, it was a disaster for the BBC in the eyes of the world. So you must have been beside yourself with worry.
Yeah, I wasn't, bizarrely. I probably should have been. I wasn't. Looking back, I should have been. The way you describe it, I should have been. I mean, we were quite systematic. We moved in over, 40-odd weeks. We built up our technological case. We got editorial teams accustomed to working there. Most importantly, we recruited lots and lots of new people, about 800 new people. So we had a lot of new people on the staff too. People who'd not, maybe some of them, so a lot of them had not worked in telly or radio or online before. So a lot of things were new, a lot of things were fresh. So we were starting to test stuff. We'd moved Match of the Day. We'd moved a number of things into Salford, and the ultimate test would be, could the BBC deliver the world's first digital Olympics, where every single thing, every single competition, from obscure stuff to really mainstream peak time stuff, could the BBC offer all of that to license fee payers through all sorts of different devices, but mainly through, red buttons and streams and all sorts of things on your telly, so that when you press your red button, if you wanted fencing, if you wanted swimming, if you wanted
badminton,
equestrian events, whatever it might be, you could get them when you wanted, as you wanted them, every single picture, every moment of action. I always remember I was in the gallery the first day that I think 24 streams went live one day, one single day. It all happened at the same time, and I went down to the sport gallery for that moment, and there was a man from BBC Sport, from BBC Future Media. We've got some amazing engineers have always been the bedrock of the BBC. The BBC has bizarrely invented just about, the whole history of broadcasted technology. The BBC has been there either inventing it or moving on. And these guys are incredible. Honestly, a lot of them are based in Salford, and thank God. And he had a gizmo. It was a gizmo. It was like a kind of, doesn't really look like, it looked like your sort of, it looked like your a credit card or just a little piece of plastic or something. But it had lots of flashing lights in it. It was like one of those things that when the guy comes round to your house and tests for gas leaks, you put it on like that, and if it it goes from green to whatever, you've got a problem. And it was a thing that was checking on the streaming, the live streaming coming back in, and we didn't know how many people would switch on all at the same time for all of this stuff. We promised that they could get it, but we didn't know whether all the gear would obviously deliver it, because we didn't know what they'd ask for. So he got the thing that showed how much capacity we had and how much capacity we remained and how much people were pulling down from their red buttons. And I think that was one of the single best moments, when I saw his little thing, his little clapometer, gasometer thing, and it showed that we'd still got quite a bit of spare capacity. It was working. It was pumping that stuff out to people's tellies and computers and all sorts of things from Salford. And we had some spare capacity in case it went crazy. Yeah, and that was a moment of some relief. But I think about that time, I think we're all on the adrenaline, we were delivering the stuff, we were in the thick of it. I knew the sport world pretty well because I'd run BBC Sport in the past. I felt we could do it. I'd worked in Manchester before. I felt that Granada had been a fantastic role model for us, all sorts of things. I felt we could build a brilliant workforce because we're the BBC, people want to come for the work for the BBC. I persuaded 50% of the staff to come with us, so I got the continuity. The important thing about wanting people to come from London was I admired and respected our staff, and I wanted a good chunk of them to come and bring their skills and bring their experience with them, because we're going to do things like the Olympic Games. But equally, I was very sanguine. I wanted to create some new roles for people. And in the end, it turned out like kind of 50-50. 50% of the staff were people who had either been in Oxford Road in Manchester, came up from London, and about 50% were entirely new. And I think that's what's given Salford both its mix of expertise, continuity, experience, and that kind of newness, a sense of pioneering.
But those that did move up from London, I mean, they were given a generous expenses package for, I think it was 2 years. there was criticism whether it was too generous or not, but they moved up, and that expense package allowed them to travel up and down where they look for houses, bring their families, etc., accommodation during the week and so on. But after 2 weeks, that 2 years, that was obviously going to end.
You could either buy or rent. Everyone
what
got the same.
Percentage of those who had moved up and stayed for 2 years then stayed on once the help was over?
Oh, the vast bulk. I mean, it depended. I mean, the people who bought, inevitably, they were a bit more committed, inevitably, because you made a different life decision. The people who rented, it was a mix. But remember, if you took the money off the BBC and moved back within a certain time, you had to pay it back. So it needed to be enough that incentivized people to make the move. We froze a lot of their London payments, so we saved a lot of money in the move. You know, it's a much more cost-effective workforce now because it's much cheaper. But if you move back within an agreed time, you pay the money back to the BBC. And you know, we did things like we reduced our workforce by 20%, we reduced our management by 30%. You know, we reduced the running costs of BBC football by £2 million a year. We made substantial savings because, you know, it's a great place with great facilities. We weren't necessarily working optimally in London because London was a legacy business. We didn't have great technology. Take BBC Sport. BBC Sport were in 7 different parts of Television Centre. Now they're in one bit of, so the you know, one bit of MediaCity in the big building on the left. So they work in a completely different way. We moved it into file-based systems from people pushing big tape trolleys around the place. It's much more efficient and much more effective. And the money, by the way, that we said we'd save for the BBC, we already paid it back. You know, and you know, the move cost us £180 million. That's on top of what it would cost us just to stand still in London. And we're on time and on time and on the budget as a consequence. So we did a few things right. Whatever the press said and whatever the press feared, it worked.
I mean, you look at it now and you travel down there, and I mean, there's no doubt MediaCity is a huge success and it's growing and growing rapidly. I mean, how many people are employed in MediaCity now?
Well, it's about 6,000, about 200 companies.
200 companies.
About 6,000 people. Yeah. Nearly half of those are BBC. We're moving moving another 300 people to MediaCity this year. So it's, you know, it's got momentum. You feel it's got momentum. You feel
and these companies that have come there are what?
They're independent television production companies. They're ITV. They're digital media agencies. They're, you know, it's Jimmy McGovern's drama company. It's the people who make Last Tango in Halifax. It's a whole bunch of different people, creative people who have a relationship with each other. People who do make graphics. People who do marketing. They're big companies. They're little companies. It's a mixed ecology.
Well, as we come towards the end of the interview. We just want to show you another clip coming up, and this is a film that's been made recently about the BBC's output from MediaCity today. All the programmes that you see, wherever they come from, that are actually made in MediaCity is what this...
Or film from the north of England, yeah.
Yeah. But based at MediaCity. Yeah. So here we go.
My name's Errol Murray, and I work here, BBC North.
The North has a very strong identity. You go up north, everything is a little bit more spikier.
It was like arriving in Willy Wonka's chocolate factory. You know, these people just think you've landed in some sort of magical place.
I'm a northern lass. It was my dream to work in children's, and now I'm able to live that dream.
Just feel this feeling of incredible excitement to be at work. That's got to be something special, hasn't it?
You can see there's something in the way.
I love the fact that BBC North feels very open, very collaborative, very can-do, there's a buzz.
Welcome to North West tonight with Annabelle Tiffin.
And Roger Johnson.
Hello and welcome back, this is Breakfast.
There's just a spirit alive in the place.
It's full of people who are really imaginative and really creative. And I think the merge of ideas that you've got here is really exciting.
Here, we can be anywhere that we want in Britain really quickly, and feels like we're at the centre of the whole of the UK.
Welcome to CBBC live in Gateshead for a very special Blue Peter.
That reaction from the audience was unbelievably rewarding. That's something that we've started since we've been in Salford Keys.
It's very important to celebrate the diversity of the country. Also scenery, attitudes, culture. They're sort of, it's a wonderful thing.
I think it's important that those people who pay the licence fee across the country feel that the BBC belongs to them and they have some sort of ownership.
Like the village and unlike the happy land, was it?
Yeah, that was very good.
I'm Catherine, by the way. I have two grown-up children, one dead, one who doesn't speak to me, and a grandson.
I like watching Match of the Day. Gary Lineker's been good on it for years.
During the World Cup and Commonwealth Games, more than 50 million people watched at least 15 minutes of BBC Sports TV coverage.
We've almost rebooted the way we do things. It's allowed us to think differently.
We're not frightened of taking a risk here. Take the digital season, 4 weeks, everyone across site in making sure we're equipped for working in the digital world.
Pretty quick that, weren't it?
We want to be the best in Europe. So the ambitions change because of the BBC.
Welcome to the BBC Philharmonic Studio in Salford. Ryder Cup Week starts here.
There's a real freedom, I like to think, that people can experiment, don't have to have a commissioned project to actually come together and think about new ideas.
Well, those revolving doors are a great opportunity just to kind of see somebody as they're coming in and going out. Oh, I didn't realise that you worked on I Wonder. Oh, I've got an idea for I Wonder. OK, the Formula One and I Wonder team have now got a project together.
We have the best bits of the BBC here. We're big enough that we can make a real impact.
Thank you very much. BBC North has a real sense of optimism. It feels like something exciting is happening.
Allah has bought me a Mercedes-Benz.
The biggest thing is to make this place feel like a stage for the whole of the north of England.
Got better landscapes, better accents, better actresses and better actors here.
Voices and accents and opinions has changed a lot because of the establishment of the BBC in Salford. This is the kind of the modernist wing of the BBC in a way.
Only a moment you say goodbye.
You've arrived just in time because I'm off on an adventure. Would you like to come too?
What's that? The number of times Sue Barker rings me on a daily basis. 39,000. The mucky woman.
Most of those were mine, Mr. Khan. As everyone knows, we Muslims are really funny.
How many people do we have in studio every year?
That's two presenter bums times 365.
Plus one sport presenter bum times 365.
And one business presenter bum times 365.
Plus an average of four guests times 365.
So that's definitely more than 1,000 different bums on this sofa.
That is just weird.
So, So, with all that coming from the north, it opens up the job opportunities for people in the north. And I mean, we have a media section here at the university. We have people on cameras here who are doing the course on the media course here. Are you able? Well, presumably you're not able, because you're the BBC, to advertise jobs for northern people. I presume you have to say it's open to the whole country, but yet you are hoping to increase the opportunity, like, for these people here in the north to get jobs.
Yeah, you'd be amazed. Wouldn't you? I mean, the largest number of new recruits are people coming from the north of England too. It's in the north of England, so inevitably, and you know, inevitably that's going to happen. And if you wander around the canteen or the offices, you just hear a range of accents you don't hear in other parts of the BBC. I mean, but you're right. We can't. You can't recruit by postcode, but we have some kind of very special relationships too, and all that. So we do a lot of work in Greater Manchester with the boroughs, bringing in apprentices and ambassadors, so kids who've not necessarily got the best start in life. or the best O-level results or whatever they might be. But maybe got none at all, maybe had trouble in school, but got a bit of promise and a bit of sparkle. And we've, you know, so far we've recruited about 80 young kids from slightly disadvantaged backgrounds, from Manchester, from, for instance, Greater Manchester Boroughs, who become part of our workforce. So we, you know, we can, in certain instances, you know, particularly where it's about developing talent who, you know, can't, by definition, can't live too far away. Economically, that can't happen. You know, there's an injection of kind of new and different DNA into our, into the BBC in Salford. And they are some of our, honestly, some of our, some of the kids we've recruited from Salford and Trafford and thereabouts are some of the best, most motivated, most interesting, most colourful people on the workforce now. And they're making a big difference. So what we can do, I think, is, I mean, there's a couple of things. One is build all sorts of relationships with universities across the north of England. So typically if we're filming a drama, for instance, in your backyard, we'd often say to kids from universities, do you want to come and be a runner on our dramas? Do you want to come and work on stuff with us? We offer lots of attachments, work placements with people. There are a lot of informal relationships between universities and the BBC from across the north of England. And, you know, we're particularly proud of our relationship with Salford. On that, we do a lot of work in Salford and Manchester schools, taking a lot of our content to kids and showing them the content, talking about what they're going to do when they grow up, doing some research with them. It's a wonderful pool of young talent to develop for the future. So I've got high hopes that over the next, you know, however many decades we're going to be in the north of England, that feeling of it being coming from the north to the UK and the world will only increase. Mm.
And what about BBC's links with business? I mean, we're at a business school here. There'll be people here all from...
We'll take money from anybody.
but do you
actually not true, by the way, I'm sadly, hardly from anybody.
But are there strong links with business, or is that something you can't get involved?
Yeah, no, of course. It depends what you mean by business. So, for instance, we have a huge number of... we procure contracts. We commission everything from programs to graphics and title sequences and data from dozens of northern companies. So we have a lot of tentacles into the kind of, in particular into the kind of digital and production sectors across the north of England. Whether you're a you know, independent radio producer, independent television producer, I would have thought by now that most companies, either from existing titles, building on existing titles or new ones, have now got trading relationships with the BBC. A huge pool of freelancers, lots of people who work for the BBC on a either casual or permanent basis now from across the north of England. So lots and lots and lots of different trading relationships. Cool. I mean, I presume that's why there are 200 companies on, you know, the MediaCity side. They're probably working with some of us, whether it's ITV or ourselves, in some aspect of our trading. So lots and lots of different business relationships across the north of England.
And finally, well, actually, maybe two tiny finalies here, but finally, MediaCity, fantastic there. And as I said, when you go down and see it, it is absolutely stunning. But how do you see it in 10 or 20 years' time?
I think it'll be one of the foremost digital media destinations in the world. I think there'll be many more people working there. I think it'll be famous for the fantastic services and content it delivers. I think these are just the founding years of MediaCity. That technology we put in, you know, the basements and the ducts of MediaCity and under the buildings of MediaCity, that now pump out all that interactivity, all those apps, all that mobile telephony. You know, there's more technology under MediaCity than in the BT Tower in London in terms of, you know, comms, all the connectivity, all the rest of it. I think it's got the potential to be an absolute world beater.
Mm-hmm. It's got all that technology, but you try to get into the Wi-Fi system if you're visiting BBC, and it's a nightmare.
That sounds like W1. Yeah.
But this is the final question. I read a list of jobs that you went through, which took half a page of reading, and you said at the end of that you didn't like settling in one place too long. You've been at MediaCity and now Director England. How long do you think you're going to be there?
Well, I've just picked up a new job, so I was director of BBC North, and now I'm director of BBC in England, which is terrific. So I've just started this new job, so hopefully this is a very difficult job this is a very difficult place to give up. This is the job I've enjoyed most, and I enjoy most, and it's going to be very difficult to walk away from this when the time comes. So hopefully for a long time yet.
Hopefully. Peter Salmon, ladies and gentlemen. Fascinating stuff. Questions you may ask now are direct to BBC Director of... Oh, I see there's loads already. Now, where should we go? Well, the microphones come to you first, and then we'll come up that way. Can you say who you are?
Yes, I'm Mark Applehurst, associate with the university through various different things. Some of this has been stolen a little bit about the next job, but if it was to stay within the BBC, and I guess it's going up the poll, would you insist on being situated in at MediaCity, or rather, the Borough of London?
That's a great question. I think it's really important is that MediaCity continues to have power to commission and control some of its own destiny. That I think one of the most important things is not all the wiring and all the decisions comes through and from London. Because I think it's very difficult to get great people, great services, all the rest of it. You're hopping backwards and forwards on the train all the time, and you've got to go backwards and forwards to London for every decision. So I think whatever happens in MediaCity, I or my successor needs to work really hard to make sure that great jobs, big decisions, you know, big ideas come from MediaCity. It's not just it's a big trading centre. It's not a kind of corner shop, this. It could help change the face of, you know, creating content and making great programs and broadcasting from the UK, this centre. It's got that potential. So whoever does the job in the future, whatever we do there in the future, you've got to have that ambition for it. You've got to insist that the BBC in the North and in MediaCity, we're still making decisions from the place, not just servicing someone else's proposition. That's really important.
Okay, we had a couple up in the middle there. There's a guy with the blue shirt, for instance, and then the guy with the suit behind him. But let's get the microphone along with him. And the mayor of Salford wants to ask a question too, which would be fascinating. Right, off you go.
Hi there, I'm Roger Gold. I run the Optigan Theatre here in Bolt, and you've touched upon this a couple of times, which is the digital era and technology. So I've got two bigger questions, but how are audiences going to interact with BBC 10, 20 years from now?
Okay. Is that the first question or second question?
That's it.
Well, great to meet you at last, by the way. I know your famous theatre very well, so that's lovely. Well, if I knew the answer to that, the multiplicity of contact points, the sophistication of the audience, the innovation that technology brings, the complexity of all of that, you know, it's only going to become more and more challenging, complex. Our need to change quickly to service it is changing. You know, what's the biggest challenge? The biggest challenge is we can't adapt quickly enough to that change. It's so profound. You know, anybody with kids will know that the multitasking, the multi-use, the multi-platform stuff, all the rest of it. Making decisions about where we place our bets in that world, how quickly to turn one thing off or, you know, switch another one on to move cash from this bit to another bit, you know, across faders between all the different platforms, that's really complex. I mean, that's the biggest single, not sure entirely answer the question, but I think it's the biggest single challenge for any media organisation, certainly for the BBC. We've had a capped license fee frozen license fee for 5 years. We've taken on another £750,000 of responsibilities. We've made 25% cuts to our budgets. I think we're getting to the point now where we're straining with that challenge. And without new investment through the new license settlement and the new charter, I think we'll have to make some very difficult decisions about what we can and what we can't do, because the constraints are, you know, they're the machine is rattling and heaving and groaning under the strain of servicing. That's how audiences are changing from 3-year-olds to 83-year-olds. And one thing the BBC prides itself on is it's a universal provider. It wants to please everybody. It wants to bring the nation together. It wants people to, for a single fee, to enjoy, 40p a day, to enjoy it all. I think it's getting harder and harder to deliver that. So whatever, we're going to either have to make some very tough decisions about ourselves or to persuade you guys and a future government to reinvest in the BBC so we can do all these amazing things. Tough period ahead, I think. But, but we feel great, by the way, having said that, it's only because we want to build on the ambition of what we started in places like MediaCity.
Can you hand the microphone too back there to the guy with the red tie?
Oh, yeah, John Shell, part-time professor here. You half answered the first question. Right. Does that mean you're moving back to London? And doesn't London see Salford Keys as a threat almost because it's cheaper to run, etc., than London?
No, I think, honestly, John, I think we've turned all that around by now. I think Salford and MediaCity is one of the BBC's greatest stories. Not to blow our own trumpet, what I mean is we do wonderful things on behalf of the whole BBC, all the 25 departments who work from there, all the big different divisions. I think they all puff out their chest and feel proud of the BBC in the north of England. And it's interesting, isn't it, the way the north is changing, all this talk about northern powerhouses, all the rest of it. I think we also breathe a sigh of relief because we've finally got facilities and program makers and journalists and technologies in the north of England with insufficient numbers, I think, to meet that ambition. So, no, I think we're in a great place. I think, in an era where budgets are constrained, to be the cheapest, most cost-effective bit of the BBC, as well as a very inventive bit of the BBC, I think it's a great place to be.
To the mayor of Salford, right there in the corner, who is indeed a former governor of this university.
Good evening. My name's Ian Stewart. As you can tell by my accent, I'm from Salford. really, Peter, you're all too modest. What you're sat below is a photograph of what is the largest purpose-built creative digital and broadcasting media centre in the whole of Europe. It's already there. And the reason that it's there is you, the BBC, mixed in with a bit of political vision that started it all off. The BBC has been the catalyst for what is a stunning story for Salford and Greater Manchester. Salford has the largest growing private house prices in the country outside London. It has the largest growing economic development statistics, 10% in the next 6 years outside London. And even if those stats are only half true, it's still staggering. And the reason that that's come about is because the BBC is the catalyst that caused it. Well, therefore, Salford and the Greater Manchester family are so beholden to the BBC. The question, of course, that I want you to answer is what next for the BBC?
Yeah.
Where's it going? Yeah. How do we not only consolidate the great development that we've had already, but how do we grow that?
Thank you. All right, thank you very much for that. I think the big thing that's happening through Salford and MediaCity for the north of England, the big influx, because we're proud of ourselves, I think, as storytellers, and we've got, tonight at 9:30, I want you all to get back and watch Peter Kay in his first, Bolton Lad, in his first BBC One sitcom. We're proud of the talent, and we're proud of the countryside and the towns. It's a spectacular place to make programmes, but we're making more and more northern stories for the world, for the UK. The big influx into MediaCity is the digital talent. So the new platforms that we're all building, the workforce which is making the red button work, doing all that clever stuff in interactivity, building the apps, doing BBC Live, doing lots, running the iPlayer. The iPlayer is pretty much run from Salford. That's fairly soon we'll have 750 technologists working from the centre, from the BBC. And of course, you know, around us, clusters of little independent companies and little specialists that we can't do that stuff. But a lot of great people. I think they are the core of the workforce that will, you know, who knows where they will go, what companies they will start, who will come in next, what will be the next wave of all of this stuff. There's another 150 move into Salford over the next 12 months who are going to be working on a more personalised version of the BBC, so it recognises you when you go on your app or your PC or your connected telly, whatever it might be. That group, that tribe, those people have got some incredible world-beating skills. I think we've got, and I think they hold the key to some of what the Northwest needs to do to make sure it can secure its digital future, some of them. And the big challenge, I suppose, just to throw back to you all, because I'm in this great educational centre, is can we continue to kind of replenish the skills pot? Can we make sure that kids coming through, can we make sure that generations coming through like me, who never thought about working in the Northwest really, because I didn't think there were jobs for people like me here. I went to London for many years, which is okay. But we need to, you know, we need to make sure those people invest in their futures in the north of England and become part of this great booming digital economy, which is going to power, I think, all the great economic sectors of the world. And I want the BBC to be at the heart of that. I think we can be at the heart of it with other partners. What I'd love from you guys, you know, you're doing great things in schools and colleges and unis like this, is keep bringing that talent through so we're not having to buy expensive talent elsewhere and ship it in, but that we can grow our own as part of this fantastic story. So that's my plea, I suppose, for this room and for Salford, who we're very proud to partner with on lots of things that we do, been so welcoming, and others around the north of England, is, you know, help us secure that digital future.
Good, right. Well, this young lady, do you want to ask a question? Fantastic. Shall we get the microphone to you so we can all, so people at the back can hear you? This is certainly the youngest member of the audience here tonight who maybe has a big future in the BBC. We'll see. Off you go with your question.
Will you make any more shows for BBC?
Me or just the BBC, you mean?
The BBC.
Yeah, I think you're going to have to come to the BBC in MediaCity and have a look at the children. You know, we've got the children's department there, so we make... I think you could be one of our star turns, I think. I can see you on Hetty Feather or Katie Morag or The Dumping Ground or Wolf Blood or all those things, hopefully. Well, some of the things that you see. So I think you've probably got a big future in our children's department somewhere, on Blue Peter or in one of our dramas.
What's your favourite programme?
It could be on another channel. It could be on another channel, be careful.
CBeebies programme.
Do you like any BBC programmes now?
Yeah.
What have you got your eye on?
I do like watching CBeebies and CBBC.
Yeah.
Good answer.
Thank you.
Right. Thank you very much. Can you give the microphone?
Just a light-hearted question to finish, because this is a question I'm going to be asked when I get home. How did that guy get Sarah Lankin?
Good one.
I've been asked that one or two times, by the way. I think you'll have to ask the wife. Well, sometimes you get lucky. I met her at work. I mean, we worked together at Granada in the 90s. And, I mean, obviously, some people have asked that question the other way around, I'd like to think. though probably not very often.
You've not met my wife.
No. And, you know, the brilliance is, you know, occasionally she works up here on dramas and we get, you know, our paths cross. So it's doubly brilliant when she's working on the patch and she's doing good things. But it's acting like any other freelance profession is a bit hit and miss. So just enjoying her being in a couple of hits at the moment. That's what's nice about it.
Thank you. As deputy mayor, does that mean you become mayor?
You
were. There goes the other way. Sometimes deputy mayor becomes mayor, etc. Right. Very good. And can I just add what George said to you, that you've been a fantastic supporter of the university and this event in particular. You're always here. And we're absolutely thrilled to see you and in many ways honoured that one of your last events as mayor is to be here and at this event tonight. And I hope just because you're not mayor after May, it means you won't come here again. We would like to see you here as often as possible. And the same goes for the mayoress. You're very welcome. Any more, or is that a wrap?
Quick one.
It's not about my wife again, is it? Well,
did you hear that at the back? All right. Yeah, you did. Good.
It's hard to answer that question.
I know.
Because I'm not a politician, and well, I think it'd be a disaster. And I know the question's hypothetical, but I, whether I've worked in the independent sector, Channel 4 or ITV or whatever, I think the BBC's, it's very important. All these other things are very important, of course they are. But I think the BBC is the cornerstone of all of that, and I think it's only the BBC which is. You know, BBC, half of its workforce, for instance, work outside London. We're very, you know, we work all over the UK. We're in communities the length and breadth of the UK. So I'd hate to think that come to pass. You know, all the opinion stuff we do with audiences around the licence fee tell us that support for the licence fee has never been greater. And you know, 40p a day for £2.80 a week, compared to what you might pay for other services that you take on subscription. I know the relationship is different. And you get Five Live and Kids and Happy Valley and BBC Sport and the news and all that objectivity and all that impartiality and all that investment in all these places all around the UK. I still think it's a fantastic deal. It doesn't mean, by the way, in a time of constrained funding everywhere, that that's an easy case to land. But I think after 5 or 6 years of no license fee rise and savings of £750 million a year on the license fee, given the new duties and obligations, it's getting tough. And I'm not saying we're more deserving than lots of other causes. I'm not. But I think the BBC is doing a good job on quite tough resources right now. So what would be the top of my election manifesto? You know, just make sure you support the BBC, because I think we deserve it.
Right. I hate not letting people ask questions who want to, so I'll take them. But if you make them short questions, and we'll take short answers, so, as I know some people have to go and have transport to catch and so on. So we've got you there, then the gentleman with his hand up just behind you, and then the guy with the glasses here, in two rows behind that, and then the guy up at the back, right? So we'll get through these quick. Go.
I'll see if Peter can answer this shortly. So from the north, we go very south. Peter, I just want to know, you know, we've talked a lot about the BBC and the Media Centre, your involvement, but from a personal question to yourself, what do you think is your greatest strength that sort of helped you along your journey to get to where you are now? And then also, what's your biggest development point, or shall I say weakness, that you have to develop to help you to get to where you are now?
What a great question. All right, short answer. First answer probably is I'm a good team worker. I love working in teams. I think I build good teams. I try and lead good teams. My biggest challenge, probably impatience. Yeah. I as time's running out, I'm getting more and more impatient.
Good. Just behind you then. Thank you. There we go.
Senior President Arthur,
As Gordon mentioned, we've got a media course here at the University of Bolton. What is the possibility that our students here get placements?
I think it's possible to do things. I think it's just give you an idea of something we did in Bolton recently, and where we devised these things. For instance, a lot of work experience. We made a series BBC One called Ordinary Lies. It was a lovely series written by a guy called Danny Brockelhurst, drama series. We ought to, I think, and we probably didn't. We should have done it. I don't think I caught it in time. We made it in a car showroom in Bolton, a lot of it. And we should have probably put some Bolton students, I think, on placements. And wherever we make programmes all around the north of England, just made a big series coming up on BBC One quite soon called Dr. Strange and Mr. Norrell. And we've got other students from York on placements working on that drama. Because one of the things that's great on your CV, is, of course, is you've done the real thing, you've worked with real teams, you've learned all that stuff. There's got to be ways we can kind of engage a bit more on all of those sorts of levels. But also, a lot of universities do things like, every now and then, just come on visits, just bring people in, just do a bit of networking, and I'd be happy to facilitate some of that. And I've also got some great, you know, colleagues here, Akhil Ahmed, Steve Mawinney, who've got big Bolton connections, and I think, you know, there's a huge amount, by the way, of Bolton talent on the... I'm thinking about lowering the... I mean, there's too many Bolton people on the BBC. Not enough Burnley people. And I, you know, it's really great talent. There really are some great networks and connections between the city and the BBC. You know, people on air, people behind the scenes, key managers. So I think, you know, develop some of those networks, but come and get stuck in. The door is, honestly, is open.
Good. The gentleman with the glasses. And then we're going to the back right.
Well, it's a quick answer. I'd take the same action that the Director General took recently. Yeah, I think he did it, you know, swiftly, clearly, properly, I think. It was the right action.
Gentleman at the top right here. I need to go to, and then I think we'll wrap after that.
Good evening, Peter. Gordon Waldron. My question is all on the people front. It talks about the cultural differences between the BBC in the south and the north. Mm. What was your engagement strategy regarding how you actually persuaded that population to come down?
Well, it was, I mean, just to, you know, without going over some of the same ground, but very good question, because I think culture's it, you know, there's a saying, isn't there? Culture eats strategy for breakfast. You've got to have a great culture. You can do anything with a motivated workforce. Mm. We've got a highly motivated workforce. All those scores that we do, you know, when we test them, they feel about working with the BBC, working with each other. They're up there at the top of the BBC, so it's a real asset for us. You know, I think a lot of it is that thing. It's head and heart. It's, you know, it's openness. It's a relationship with the audience. You know, this being a business guy, you know, who are we serving? What do they want? How can we please them? How can we get out there and engage with them? It's some of all that stuff. The biggest thing for us, I think, as an institution, is to learn how to be more and more open. An openness about our culture, an openness about our audiences, an openness about the site. You know, if you try to drill it down to a single thing, it's a kind of culture of openness, I think. And, you know, I think we're on the way. There's something about, also, I think, about the north, you know, just to end on this note, it's a bit parochial, but there's something about the warmth and the fun. And the storytelling that's somehow abroad in the air in the north of England, which we're syringing at the moment and sticking, you know, in that place in MediaCity too. And all that stuff about the north and its character is such a big asset for us.
Right, thank you very much for that and all those questions. We're going to wrap it now. And in so doing, I want to try and tease out of you to finish on a nice note and a light note, if I can. And you don't know that I'm going to do this, so I hope you remember the story I'm trying to tease out of you, but it was told to a colleague of mine, because here you are, this very important man in the BBC, Director England BBC, you've risen right to the top, and yet the boy from Burnley it's keeping your feet on the ground, and nobody does that better than people from Burnley to keep people's feet on the ground. And you were approached one time by a guy who recognised you. Tell us that story.
I did. Yeah, you're right. I think it's very, very important. I mean, I love my hometown, and they absolutely hold you to account. You know, everybody's equal in Burnley, and I love it. Yeah, I think the story you're talking about is I went into a pub about, I don't know, some years ago, 10 years ago or something, and I was at the bar, and quite a tough, chunky-looking bloke approached me at the bar. I just knew the way he was wading through the crowd coming towards me, that it was going to be interesting. I got a bit of a tank top on, you know, and it's quite kind of hairy arms and things, and he comes up and he just taps me on the shoulder, and he singles me out and goes, "Hey, mate." I could see my mates were thinking, "Oh, there's somebody's going to kick off here," you know, one of those moments. And he said, are you that Peter Salmon?" I went, I am, yeah. I was backing off a little bit. I just thought I'd just get a few centimetres. He said, "Have you been at Granada Television working on Coronation Street?" I said, "I have, yeah." He said, did you do some of that Wallace and Gromit animation, you know, the Wallace and Gromit stuff?" I said, "I did, yeah, that was amazing, I did that." And he said, "Have you been running BBC Sport?" Yeah, I said, I have. I was thinking, I don't know where this is going, this. And he said, are you with that Sarah Lancashire? I said, "I am, yeah." He went, "Can I use the word?" He said, "You fuck all in Burnley."
Lovely story. I'm sorry, I forgot, Grace. We had a young person here. Yeah. But you found it very funny. Anyway, so sorry. It was my fault for saying yes, tell it, and then I suddenly realised. Oh,
sorry.
Anyway, I promised you at the beginning that I thought you'd have a fascinating and absorbing evening, and I think Peter has delivered that. So would you join me? It's a great boost to this university to have something like that. Thank you, Peter Salmon. Thank you. Brilliant. Absolutely brilliant. Thank you.